everybody. Welcome to the Hallmarkies podcast. Today we are talking about the off-network Christmas movies that we saw over this last weekend. And we're covering four different Lifetime movies and a couple other films I'm going to briefly talk about. But I am film critic Rachel Wagner, and I have a special guest with me today. Today, Gina is here from the Cozy Cabin podcast. And thank you so much for coming on the podcast.
Well, thanks for having me. I really appreciate it. We kind of finally dusted everything off and we got the cabin open again.
Yay! I know. I'm so glad. I know you had a pretty crazy fall, as we all have had. But you're back covering some Christmas movies. And why don't you, for people that are new to your podcast, why don't you tell people a little bit about yourself and about what you do on the podcast?
Yeah. So My podcast partner and I, Emily, we have an absolute love for Hallmark movies. And we decided last year that we were going to take our love and do something about it. So, and we wanted everyone to feel welcome, and we wanted a place that was warm and cozy. So we built the Cozy Cabin, and we sit around and talk about Hallmark movies. We drink cozy drinks, and we have a really good time.
Yeah. I'm so glad to have you back. I wasn't able to be on the last episode that you were on of our podcast. That was way back in January.
Yeah. Crazy. We were just reliving that today.
So glad to finally get to talk with you. And yeah, we're going to talk in some Lifetime movies. I would say that this weekend was a little bit stronger than some of the previous weekends.
I would agree.
Their slate hasn't been as good as Hallmark's this year as a whole, but they had some decent ones, I thought, this weekend. And so that's going to be fun. And I have three other little reviews that I'm going to sprinkle in amongst all of these. One I wanted to talk about first before we get to the first Lifetime is called The Christmas Dilemma. This is on TV1, and this movie is, if you like the sort of family shenanigans type of holiday movie, then I think people might enjoy it. It does have quite a bit of mature content, so it probably not going to be for the average Hallmarkies listener. There's a long scene in an exotic club, and there's some other things like that. So I guess it won't be for everyone, but I did appreciate the fact it's the only holiday film I have seen this year that has talked about Kwanzaa. So if people celebrate that, that's kind of nice. And it's directed by Essence Adkins, and she did a really good one last year for TV1 called Coins for Christmas, and with her acting in it. And then there was a follow-up to Coins for Christmas this year, and this summer, that was also quite good. So I would recommend Coins for Christmas if they replay it over this new Christmas Dilemma. But if it sounds like your thing, go give it a shot. All right. Well, let's talk about Too Close for Christmas. This is stars Chad Michael Murray and Jessica Lowndes. And it's a woman's feeling starts to change when she reluctantly spends Christmas with the man responsible for ending her last relationship. So overall, before we dive into it, what was your overall thoughts about this movie?
Well, I'm a fan of both actors, and especially Chad Michael Murray. He legitimately cracks me up. So I kind of love his shenanigans, and he always has shenanigans. Like whatever his role is, you know, that's kind of always his backstory, is he's this, you know, playboy kind of guy that's always into shenanigans. And so I was ready for that, and I liked the whole idea of the adoption. I love the fact that she was adopted. That was an interesting storyline. Mm-hmm. And then showing up and he's there, and then it's the whole Barnett family Christmas. So I thought it was very cozy, very, very Christmassy. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, it was fine. I enjoyed it. It was pretty pretty standard to me. It was pretty by the books, but that's not necessarily a bad thing. I like these two leads quite a bit, except for I don't know what was happening with his hair. It was very distracting. I try not to comment on an actor's personal appearance too much, but it was a weird color, and it was all over the place. I said it looked like Guy Fieri's hairdresser had like wandered in and styled his hair. And I was like, what's happening? It was all okay. Spiky and that's all over the place.
Yes. It's very funny you should say that, because halfway through the movie, I actually wrote down, it looks like he slept on his hair and went right to work.
Yeah. So yeah, it was I don't know. It was like people had like played with his hair, and then it was like swiped over, and then it was a really weird color. And I was just like, what is happening? I mean, I know that we've gotten a lot of quarantine hair.
Yeah, that's
this
true.
Season.
That's true.
And that's been interesting, but I don't know what he did with his quarantine hair. Was like kind of styled, but then not styled.
I've always been really so jealous of hair like that, because he literally could walk out of his trailer and go straight to work. Yeah, no one would know.
I think not only could he did.
He did.
I think he did.
It's exactly what happened.
Yeah. So that was very strange. I also thought this was so strange, the way that they kept shaming her for eating too much granola. Like, what is wrong with eating granola? Like, she was almost like embarrassed. Yeah, you keep eating granola. I'm like, what?
But she was like, they made her out to be like a granola hoarder, because she had it in her pockets and in her clothes, and she was always like nibbling in these little bags. I'm like, it's really not that big of a deal.
I know. I mean, it's not like I was just kind of baffled by it. I'm like, it's a perfectly respectable snack.
Yeah. I was just like, well, at the very beginning, when she had all the little bags beside her in the car, I seriously thought she was eating like cheeseburgers or something. I'm like, oh, okay. Because, you know, she's got this great body, and now she's eating a ton of cheeseburgers. I see why she would hide it. But no, she was eating granola.
Yeah. So, it's a perfectly normal snack.
Okay, you can do that.
Right? I don't know. It was definitely a problem for her. That is like granola equaled stuck up in the world of this movie. You gotta be more of a free spirit and
that's right.
Eat less granola. What? So that was confusing, but for the most part, it was a fun enough movie. I thought that her reason for hating him was pretty weak. I don't know, what do you think about
theory?
Because he had stood up. He had said something about how she deserved better.
Right.
And it had caused her to sort of rethink her relationship. But she was mad at him for pointing out that she was in a bad relationship. I mean, shouldn't you be kind of grateful? Right.
Well, yeah. And I think that he was even taken aback why she was mad. You know?
Yeah.
He was like, I was
that's
just
right.
saying it like it was. What's the big deal?
Yeah.
So, yeah. The whole
she was
thing
like, you're mad at me?
Yeah.
Because, I mean, I guess she just wanted to blame somebody for the breakup of her relationship.
Yes. And she pegged it all on him.
Yeah. So she blamed it on him. Yeah. And, which he sounds like he was a really lame guy. So,
right.
Again, she should be grateful.
Well, he had her qualifications. He had a British accent and a suit. So
mm-hmm.
that's what she
right.
had been going for up to that point.
Yeah. Yeah, do you have a favorite Jessica Lowndes Hallmark role?
Oh, I like the Pimberly,
mm-hmm.
the one where she sings
yeah.
at the end. That she has such a beautiful voice.
Mm-hmm.
She has such a beautiful.
Yeah, I like Magical Christmas Ornaments too. The one thing I like about Magical Christmas Ornaments is that she kind of doesn't like Christmas, and the script doesn't make a big deal out of it. Like, it's it's like really unusual.
Yeah,
and yeah, she's just kind of like not into it, and she's busy, and there's also the evil podcaster in that movie, which makes me laugh because it's very. Because her ex is like went on a podcast, and that was very, very questionable. But that one's probably my favorite of hers, I think.
Yeah,
but anyway, and so yeah, she can be a lot of fun, and then you have his. They're all visiting for the weekend. Mm-hmm. His mom, is. Sick, and he's the brother of her brother-in-law, correct?
Right. Mm-hmm.
Paul, Chad Michael Murray's character. And so his mom gives him a to-do list, mm-hmm. right?
Right.
To get done, because she's sick.
Right.
Well, then her sister is pregnant and can't help, so she says, will you help Paul?
Right.
And I forget what the brother-in-law is doing.
He's tending to his pregnant wife. And
right,
so,
okay.
Of course, with the list, and then, you know,
yeah.
Hilarity ensues.
So the list ends up involving ice skating, Christmas tree
of course.
Selection,
mm-hmm.
and planning the town event.
Yes.
Yeah, and so that's a lot of shenanigans going on, and then she gets the promotion at work. She's mm-hmm. like an event planner, correct?
Right. Which most people are.
Yeah, that's right. Or a photographer. So that's like the other job in these movies.
Yeah.
Photographer. If they want to make him like a creative type, it's a photographer. So she gives him these special cufflinks.
Uh-huh.
They have a near kiss by the fire.
Yep.
And then I was proud of her because she had such a pretty dress for the gala.
Yes.
And it was red,
mm-hmm.
which I don't like it when they wear black dresses in these movies. So I was so happy to see her with a red dress, with a very pretty dress.
Mm-hmm.
And I was kind of confused. So she breaks up with him, or they have a fight because he travels too much and that's a problem.
Yeah.
Right?
You know, the writing's not the best. I mean, for that point, you could have made a better point. There could have been a better fight. It didn't hold water with me.
Yeah. I was kind of like, when did this become a problem for her character? And if he travels, you don't have any children. It's not like either of you have children or.
Right.
So what? Who cares? What's the problem? But anyway, and then he makes her this interesting clock. What did you think of the clock?
Well, it was interesting. The elf alarm in his room from fifth grade was hilarious.
Yeah.
That thing was like a screaming goat when it went off. It was horrible. So, I mean, it was cute, you know? It was cute. I liked it.
Interesting code for terrifying. It was an interesting clock. But that wins her over. Yes. They make up. There's the carriage ride Christmas morning. And she's like, oh, I'm not going to go. But then he's there.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah. I mean, this, like I said, to me, this is like a classic. It checks all the boxes. It's perfectly fine. I didn't like love it, but it's fine. So I would give it like a 3.5 stars out of 5.
Out of 5, yeah. I would easily say a 3. Because like you said, it does. It definitely checks all the boxes. Good act. I mean, the stars, that they're, you know.
Yeah, they bring it.
They bring it, definitely. But yeah, I would probably have it on again. I don't know that mm-hmm. I would sit and watch it, but I would have it on.
You'd have a background.
It
passes background.
Yeah.
Grace, okay, good. And you'll never think of granola the same way after watching this movie.
Never. Never. Ever. Never again.
Maybe it was if it had been like Christmas granola, like with I don't know.
Cinnamon and chestnuts or something.
Yeah, that's right. All right. Well, next up we had Let's Meet Again on Christmas Eve. And this was written by friend of the podcast, Carly Smale, who we love. And she is such a great writer. And I love her Christmas pen pals so much. If you have you seen Christmas pen pals?
I have not.
Oh, you've got to see it.
Well, it's I will now.
One of my favorites, okay. Sarah Drew, and she also did Snowed in Christmas with Andrew Walker and Justin.
Now you're talking.
Yeah, Bethany Joy Lenz. She's a really fun writer. And I would say that that is the strongest part of this movie is the writing, I think. But overall, would you? I guess I should say what it is. Just one sec. So Let's Meet Again on Christmas Eve stars Kyla Pratt and Brooke Starnell. And it is a couple miss their shot at romance, only finds that they're reunited only to find that they are reunited couple years later while they are thrust into joint event planning for a Christmas wedding. Mm-hmm. So overall, what did you think about this one?
Well, I have to tell you, I sat down to watch it in the very beginning where we had the narrators begin the tale. That captured me right away because it was so magical and endearing. And I loved it. I loved the backstory. So it held my attention the entire time, which is difficult for me because I have a 3-year-old. And but it definitely held my attention. It was interesting. It was very Christmassy and cozy. I really enjoyed this one.
Yeah, this one was pretty good. I enjoyed it too overall. I do think it's a little bit hard with Kyla because she has such a young voice, and I feel like I kind of wish they had kept her character in that college setting. But I don't know. I feel like it makes it a little hard for me to feel the chemistry between her and the leads that she's in these romantic movies because she seems so much younger than she really is.
You know, that's interesting because there was something amiss for me and I couldn't nail it. And that's what it was.
Yeah. And she seems like a sweetheart. She does a good job. It's just something out of her control. And I feel bad for saying that. But it just seems, it does hurt the chemistry a little bit. But aside from that, I still enjoyed it. It was a cute movie. It starts out with them in college. Mm-hmm. They are in love. And he is got this chance to go to Italy for this 2-year program where he's going to train to be a photographer. Sometimes they give the photographers are men in these movies. And I guess I always want to say, like, nobody go abroad when you're in love. Like, it just leads to problems. But it just comes up all the time.
Immediately when they decide contract, meet in 2 years, and my wife and I looked at each other and said, an affair to remember. So we're like, okay, obviously one of them's not going to be there in 2 years. And I felt like the reason that they should not have been there or would not have been there should have been much more epic.
Yeah, so he kind of thinks that she's with somebody else, and it just doesn't feel like it's feels like she kind of judges her and says, "Oh, it wasn't real to you. It wasn't a real commitment." Whatever, he decides not to go.
Right. He saw that contract as a breakup.
Yeah, so they make this contract with this tale of the shoemaker, and that. That had a love and they made a contract or something like that. I can't remember exactly, but they agree to meet again in 2 years, but it fails. And you're right. I do also agree that that, because spoiler alert, there's like a much, much, much bigger reason in an affair to remember why they don't meet up.
Exactly.
Yeah. You know,
I mean, a bus should have been involved here, you know?
Yeah.
Something should have been involved here. And it was just like, I thought you broke up with me, so I didn't show up.
Yeah. You were the closest place to heaven. You were there. The best. And if you think you like Sleepless in Seattle, then you need to see An Affair to Remember.
Oh, yes.
Both good movies. But
so I thought, too, like, the very first time that they see each other is at the wedding, or the venue for the wedding, because he's the photographer, she's the planner. And the first time they see each other, I think to myself, I would have grabbed him and said, "Where were you?"
Yeah.
You know, it is also calm and laid back. Like,
I mean, I guess they're professionals.
I guess.
I mean, it is kind of interesting that they need the photographer to be involved in all of the planning phases of the wedding. Like, usually the photographer, I think, just maybe shows up to the rehearsal, maybe. But this is a vow renewal. Mm-hmm. And it's very hardcore, this vow renewal.
Yes, it is.
There's their daughter, Tracy.
What did you think of her?
Yeah, I'm curious. She was hilarious. I loved her. And she was totally over the top and ridiculous.
Very.
But I still thought she was really funny.
Well, I thought she was hilarious. And then she became endearing.
Yes.
Like, as you saw her, you know, show the love for her parents, then I was like, oh, okay, I love her. But yes, she was hilarious.
Yeah, agreed. And she's kind of like sort of a Cher Horowitz type kind of type character. Like, very.
That is so true.
What did you think of the family Christmas charades?
Yeah, that was, neither one of them wanted to have any part of that. But they reluctantly went along with it.
Yeah.
See, my family does nothing like that. So I feel like it's unfair of me to judge.
Uh-huh. I thought it was a highlight of the film. I mean, my family is big into games. Uh-huh. So that was really fun. And I totally want to play Christmas family charades. If we're ever able to get together.
Yeah. Can you do it over Zoom right now? Because that's going to be it.
Yeah. And so they go wedding dress shopping. Mm-hmm. They purchase a wedding dress for, I forgot to write down the name of the person who's having the vow renewal. But they purchase a dress for her.
Right.
And then you have the charades, and we find out that Kylie's character, that her dad has Alzheimer's. Mm-hmm. And he's forgetting who she is. And she's just really devastated. And so
you kind of know all along that something's going on, because every time he mentions her dad, she has, you know, there's a reluctance there. So we know something's going on.
Yeah, that's right. And so he rents out the ice skating rink in town.
Mm-hmm.
And for her, and they actually have a pretty early kiss in this movie.
Yeah, very early. Fun.
Yeah. And then she freaks out because she realizes that she left the dress, the wedding dress, at the cleaners.
And the lady's on vacation, so that's it.
Yeah, so she can't get a dress. And it's a huge problem, and they're going to fire her.
I have a bit of a problem with this, because they have been like super laid back, highly supportive.
Right.
And she's been able to fix every problem. And then suddenly it's, you know, the end of the world.
And especially because you're asking somebody to plan this somewhat large event, or this important event, in like, what, 2-3 days?
Right. I mean, really, she found you one dress. She can find you another one. Everyone just calm down.
Yeah. I agree. And I think I felt like Tracy was kind of trying to say that, like, calm down.
Yeah.
It'll work out. It'll be okay.
I'll fix it.
And But then she kind of blames him. She's sort of mad at him.
Oh, which she I lets didn't him like. Have it. Yeah.
Yeah. She's like, you distract me and I got to, you know, work on my career, which I just, I mean, the amount of trouble that careers cause during Christmas time in these movies, it's just like nobody work at all. That's what I think. I'm reaching the point in my Christmas viewing that I start to have Garland overload. You didn't as much in this movie, but I start to get a little crazy when I start seeing like Garland on the range hood and over every piece of molding.
So we have a running joke on our podcast because I am the queen of decorating, and I always try to get Garland in a room to see how much I can push it. So that's our, I added Garland to the upper, like the ceiling part of our room, just to see what my wife would say. She's fine with it so far. So last weekend I was on the roof adding Garland.
Oh my gosh. See, that's when you know you married well, when they're just like, oh, look at you and that's your shenanigans.
Yes.
Your Garland.
She's so supportive. When I got stuck on the roof, she was totally fine with it. She talked me down.
That's couple goals right there. Relationship goals right now.
Someone who will talk you down on the roof.
Yeah. And so there's also, it's the couple's uncle.
Yes, right? Uncle Bernie.
He's there to do he's the officiant. Mm-hmm. And he also is a shoemaker.
Uh-huh.
And yeah, very subtle.
Yes.
And so he tries to like get everybody to calm down and you know, basically says like, you were able to find a wedding dress, you were able to find another. And so she does, she calls and then Tracy tells Kyla's character to about Rob and that he hasn't dated anybody since college and that basically that he's not interested and she must have been so amazing, that girl in college, because he's had no interest in anybody else. I really liked that. That was it. And then see her face.
Yep.
And she's like, oh. It's good. And so then we have the wedding, and they were very careful to say, oh, only 25 people. You know, obviously that was a COVID thing, but so they were able to kind of get away with it being small. And I think that they had it was a pretty wedding. I would be very irritated though, even outside of COVID, if anyone invited me to a Christmas Eve wedding vow renewal, because a vow renewal you can do anytime.
Yes.
You're taking up my Christmas Eve for your vow renewal.
I would agree. But my only caveat to that is if they're paying for the entire thing, it is at an inn in Connecticut. So maybe if I'm taking my family with me, I could suffer through for a year.
Maybe. But it's just like, that's when you're with families Christmas Eve.
Right.
Almost more than Christmas. I would be, because like, once you open the presents on Christmas, there's really not a ton going on, at least in my house. You know, you're just kind of playing with the games and toys and stuff like that. So like, if something was on Christmas evening, that would be fine actually for me, but Christmas Eve evening, I have lots going on.
So you're out.
Something.
You're out.
No, don't invite me to your vow renewal. Maybe. I mean, I guess if it's a destination wedding and I get to go somewhere really amazing, I will attend.
Yeah.
But
you'll consider
other than that,
it.
Pick a different day. You can do it the 22nd or the 23rd. Don't do it on Christmas Eve.
But have me out by the 24th.
Yes. I mean, come on. But anyway, so she leaves and she's kind of chasing her down. She thinks that, I forget why she leaves. She's mad at him for some reason. She doesn't.
Well, he had said, let's do a redo. And she just,
Yeah.
The whole thing is kind of blowing up, but then Bernie gives them the two stockings. So Bernie's like a touch of magic in the movie.
Yeah, he's like a wink wink kind of Christmas magic. And so then she goes to the tree and she's talking to the tree. And there he is. Yay.
Right on the other side.
Yeah.
And they both have their sides of the contract.
Yep.
And they both end up happily ever after. The only thing that was missing for me was I really, really wish that they would have done the narrator at the end as well.
That would have been nice. I agree.
Yeah, because that would have, you know, put a nice little bookend on it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we should have gotten a happy ending for Tracy as well, because she's hilarious. Could have ended up with somebody like at the wedding or whatever that she meets her.
They could have done a year later.
Yeah, that would have been good.
That's my favorite thing about movies is when they do a year later.
Yeah. They also had the reason why he didn't show up at the tree was because he thought that she was dating her boss, her boss is gay. And it was kind of like, really, a couple questions could have cleared that right up for you. I mean, come on.
Like she said, if you just would have looked up who Victor was.
Right.
She would have seen pictures of him and his husband.
Yeah.
Cleared the whole thing right up. A little
Facebook search.
Yeah.
Solved all the problems.
Seven years of problems.
Yeah. Right. Exactly. So how many stars did you give this one?
I would probably say 3.5.
Yeah, I agree. Like I said, I think the writing elevated it. And it was fun. 3.5 as well for me. Hi, everybody. We'd like to take a second and thank our sponsors for this episode of the podcast. They're the good folks over at Care Of. And Care Of is a wellness brand that makes it easy to maintain your health goals with a customized vitamin plan that helps you feel your best today and supports you long term. What they do is they have high quality products that meet personalization. If you go onto their website, takecareof.com, you can take their online quiz. And this quiz is a 5-minute quiz that asks you questions about your diet, lifestyle, and health concerns to help you address your specific wellness goals. It only takes a few seconds. And when I took the quiz, we're able to narrow it down to my sleep needs being my highest point of concern. And we're able to get the vitamin plan that I needed for that concern. Care Of's holistic online quiz is like getting a one-on-one consultation with a nutritionist, all without leaving your home. They have products that are formulated with good-for-you clean ingredients that are backed by science. Care Of is super transparent about the research and sourcing behind each one of their products. And you get recommendations come in daily, individualized, wrapped packets that are perfect for getting back into routine. And I think if you were looking for a stocking stuffer or a gift for a athlete or anybody really in your life, I think that a subscription to Care Of is a perfect choice. Right now, the seasons are changing. It's important to get ahead of taking care of your immune health. It takes about 30 days for your body to adapt to new nutrients. So now is a great time to update your vitamin and wellness routines to help support your immune system this fall. Care Of's products go beyond vitamins and supplements to include protein powders and boosts to help supplement your workouts as you move indoors in these colder months. So check out Care Of. I think you'll really enjoy the products and it could be perfect for anybody in your life. You're looking for a unique, thoughtful gift. Check out Care Of for 50% off your first Care Of order. Go to takecareof.com, enter code HallmarkEase50. That's 50% off your first Care Of order. Go to takecareof.com, enter code HallmarkEase50. So one bizarre Christmas movie that came out this year, people are looking for something different. I can't say I'd recommend it even then, is a movie called Fat Man, which has Mel Gibson playing a disgruntled, angry Santa. And I actually am up for different kinds of Christmas movies, darker fare. Like as much as I cover all the Hallmark fare, I'm fine with something like Gremlins or Anne in the Apocalypse or, you know, whatever. And So I'm good with it, but it just wasn't that well done. And I feel like something that's about a disgruntled Santa should have kind of a twinkle in its eye and be a little campy.
Mm-hmm,
I kept thinking of in Scrooged with the night the reindeer died, the advertisement at the beginning of Scrooged, the Lee Majors action film. Yeah. It's just ridiculous. And I felt like instead of doing that for this movie, they went totally realistic and gritty and kind of just unpleasant. I didn't enjoy it. But the only reason I mention it is because I was on a podcast where we talked all about it and kind of other different against the grain kind of Christmas movies. Mm-hmm. It's a podcast is called The Lamb Cast. And so people, if they want to hear more from me, not that you don't get enough of me, then check that out. I think you might enjoy it. It was fun. Even though I didn't love the movie, it was fun to be on there. So
it's good to hear your take on it, because I saw that on iTunes and I was wondering, I was wondering how it went. So
I like the idea in theory, but not in execution. So I feel like it should have been more fun with Mel Gibson and Walter Goggins and people like that.
Mm-hmm.
Involved. And it's well made as far as cinematography and all that kind of stuff, but not for me.
Okay.
So, all right. Next we have Christmas Ever After. I'm so excited to talk to you about this movie.
Okay.
So this stars Daniel D. Tomaso and Ali Stroker. Mm-hmm. It's directed by Pat Keeley, who I got to talk to and interviewed this week. And it's popular romance novelist Izzy Simmons spends every Christmas at her favorite snowy bed and breakfast. But this year she's faced with an impending deadline and a severe case of writer's block. Luckily, inspiration strikes in the unlikely form of the B&B's new owner, Matt, who bears an uncanny resemblance to Izzy's novels, his handsome hero, as both partake in the lodge's annual itinerary of Christmas activities. Izzy's writer's block is cured, and the first pages of her and Matt's own love story may just be beginning. So, what overall did you think about this movie?
I liked it. I think that I wish that our two leads would have had a little more chemistry together.
Uh-huh.
I didn't. It was really hard. She was an utter joy to watch on screen.
Yeah.
I mean, she was so incredibly filled with the Christmas spirit. I absolutely love that. I love that she travels to this place and has her Christmas every year. And she knows the town. The town knows her. That's the only thing. I liked the story. I liked everything. I just wish they would have had a little more chemistry.
That's interesting. I love this movie. Mm-hmm. I actually got to see it early.
Uh-huh.
So I've been sitting on this movie for 3 weeks waiting for everybody else to see it, because I was lucky to be able to get to screen it early. And I just love this movie. I think I actually don't have a problem with their chemistry.
Really?
Yeah, I thought that they had pretty good chemistry, but I just loved her. I completely agree with you. I thought she was so delightful.
Oh,
and
yes.
I loved the story. I thought it was so funny. The whole idea of her seeing the man from her romance novels and being freaking out. I really thought that was a funny script. And I do think it meant something to me, the fact that we have our first heroine in a wheelchair, and the way that the film kind of treated that was just so great. I felt like it wasn't even a part of the story. She just was who she was, and that's awesome.
I agree 100%, because that's exactly the way it should be.
Yeah, exactly.
I loved it. It's hilarious when she is, she's got this writer's block. And she wheels into town and literally almost hits him.
Yeah. So she it was so good.
She goes up on the sidewalk, and then there is the lead character of the books right in front of her car.
Yeah. And I also love the fact that she is calling her boss, the editor or whatever, from her car. And she's well, it's a good thing, because I'm heading there right now. she was just, there was no like hemming and hawing. Am I gonna, should I go to the inn for Christmas or whatever? She was just like, I'm on my way. So it was so funny. And I don't know, I love the fact that she, because if you think about it, like how do you do the meet cute with her, like with her being, because you, I don't know, you wouldn't want her like running into him with her wheelchair, like that would be weird, I feel like. So the fact that she like practically crashes into him was hilarious, I thought. And
they never really, he never really realizes that it's her.
Yeah,
they just like, for the next, you know, they keep running into each other over and over and over again.
And one of the things the director said to me was that they really tried to, at the beginning of the movie, he's kind of standing and he's very tall, which I thought was kind of a bold casting choice for her being seated the whole movie, obviously. And and so as he's getting more attracted to her, he gets lower. You know, there's more scenes with him sitting and her sitting.
Yes.
And, you know, things like that. And I thought that was really good and well done. And
it becomes much more personal, much more intimate between them as the movie goes on.
Yeah. And I loved their banter, like when she's getting all upset about the squeaky floors and all that stuff. It was so cute. I just loved her and it was really fun. And I really liked the inn owner, Bob, his dad. Yeah. I thought he was really charming. I liked that actor. I thought he did a good job.
Yeah, he was. I agree. The whole, it was just, you know, from our podcast point of view, we always look for the cozy, and this was a cozy one. This was very definitely cozy.
Yes. And do you feel that oatmeal raisin is a cookie worthy of Christmas?
Well, I'm going to have to say yes, because it's my wife's favorite. so I would be in trouble if I didn't. Not my personal favorite, but I'm going to have to go with yes.
Okay. I don't know. I mean, I think there'd be some cookie shaming on my part there. Oatmeal raisin. I mean, you can't even make it into a Christmas shape. Or put any kind of decorative icing on it. It does not count.
You can sprinkle cinnamon. That's good enough.
I guess. Maybe for fall. Yeah. It seems like we're a fall color cookie. I love the fact that they worked in the Wassail song for her to sing, because of course she's a Tony Award winning singer.
Right. And that was beautiful.
Really fun. Yes. Beautiful. I've loved that this whole season, whether on Lifetime or Hallmark Channel, working in these Broadway actors and getting them to sing has been really fun.
Giving them a chance to work, because it's so hard right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
I have a friend whose brother is in The Lion King, and he obviously has not been able to work since last spring. And it's really hard.
It makes me so sad. Yeah. I was watching the Rockettes Christmas Spectacular, which is amazing, and I absolutely loved it, on Peacock Network, if anybody has it, and I was just crying. Like, it's so sad.
I know.
I'm so sad about it. So I really loved the whole scene when they were locked in her room.
Yeah, the doorknob.
I just thought that was really well done. He's the classic kind of hot widower we talked about in our podcast. Of course, his daughter was really cute.
She was a writer. That was really funny at the beginning when she was in the hallway spying on him, and she turns around and talks to Casey, not realizing that that's Matt's daughter.
Yeah,
that was hilarious.
It was so good. Yeah. And I loved little scenes like when he kind of pushes her up the ramp, and they're holding hands that way. That was really sweet. And I again, in my interview with the director, he said that a lot of that came from Ally herself.
Uh-huh.
Because she's engaged. And so I guess she kind of brought a lot of stuff from her relationship
into
which is awesome.
Yeah.
I hope we get to see a lot of her, because I just loved her. And I like when he said the view is better from down here. That was so cute.
That was very
cute. I loved that. We also got the scene with him trying to figure out what is he going to do. Because once he finds out his wife painted her book covers, he's kind of torn up about it. And we get a little shirtless shot, which was kind of nice. He's like, thank you, Lifetime.
I did like that he does, though, eventually back up and realize that it was his wife that brought him to her.
Yeah, I think that's how he which was so it. Nice.
Yes. I really like that.
So then you have Jennifer coming in,
mm-hmm.
and she's like the activities committee leader or something like that. Something like that. And so Izzy starts to feel kind of jealous and insecure
mm-hmm.
about Jennifer and Matt, and they knew each other in high school kind of thing. And they have this decoration competition and they win, which was fun.
That was fun.
Yeah. And I like how Bob, he hurts his ankle. And he's just like, you miss all the jumps that you don't take.
Yeah.
In life.
He took the jump.
He was cool. Yeah. And anyway, then Izzy sees Jennifer and Matt at the competition, and she gets really insecure, and she gives her book a sad ending.
Yeah.
And she starts on her way.
She sees them hug each other.
Yeah. And in the morning.
Yeah.
Yeah. She leaves and she's talking to the editor, and the editor's like, pull over right now.
Yeah.
It was great. I love that editor. She was awesome.
Yeah, I did too. I loved her.
She was so good.
But and I felt so bad for Matt and Casey, because, you know, he like comes bounding down the stairs on Christmas morning. He's ready to have breakfast, and then she's gone.
I felt so bad too. And so then she turns around, she comes back, and I really liked that too, that I don't know, for like everything, there was never a sense of anybody like, I'll like you even though you have a disability. That wasn't like that at all.
Right.
In this case, it was her deciding that she would be accepting of him.
Yeah.
And his whether she could love him. Like, yeah. It was all about her, which of course is the way it should be.
Right. It was a great turnaround, I thought.
Yeah. Yeah. And so then he gives her the doorknob,
which is adorable.
It was so cute. I loved it so much. And everything ends happy and they're happy. And I mean, I guess if I was going to nitpick, because I love this movie, I guess they did the kisses through a piece of plastic or whatever, then they removed it. I don't know if you saw that.
No, I didn't.
Yeah, there's an article about it.
I thought the COVID. Camera angles were weird.
I agree. I also thought the camera angles were weird on the kiss.
Yeah.
It was kind of from her back, and you couldn't really see it, right? And I was like, why did they do that? That was weird. And so I guess it was a COVID thing, but
oh, well, that explains a lot, because I was like, what is going on with these angles? I don't want you to see the back of her head.
Which is weird, because I mean, they're in such close, if she had COVID, like, I feel like if she would give it to him regardless of whether they were kissing or not kissing. So if you're going to take the risk of being together, you might as well do the kiss the right way. I don't see any reason to do it in plastic.
I agree completely, because you're already spending that much time together.
Yeah.
You're already within the 6 foot distance. Film, right.
Then it's safe enough to kiss film.
But that explains everything. Because yeah. I thought that was the weirdest kiss. I was like, wait, wait, I can't see anything. Wait a minute.
Yeah. So this is actually either my first favorite or second favorite Christmas movie of 2020. I loved it. I just thought it was so romantic and sweet. Uh-huh. And I loved her. And I thought it was funny. And so, and something different. So I have a very high score for it. I'm going to give it a 4.8.
Wow.
Stars. Yeah. I loved it. That's I have very awesome. Few flaws with it. Yeah.
Yeah.
What will you give it?
I'm going to stick to a 3.5, just because,
yeah,
I, like I told you, I love the story, and I, oh my gosh, she just made me happy. And but I just, the for me, the chemistry wasn't as strong as I would like to it,
yeah,
or it had been.
And that's totally understandable. Well, real quick, I wanted to give my little review of a movie called I Hate New Year's. And this movie is a feature film, but that you can get on VOD. And it is about a singer who comes home for New Year's. She's kind of struggling. She's there with her BFF friend who secretly is in love with her. And they end up going out on New Year's, even though she hates New Year's. And they have all kinds of shenanigans. And maybe they realize they might have more in common than they thought, more in love with each other, whatever, than they thought. And so this I think it is very small budget. So you can feel it sometimes. Not all the acting is like great. But overall, I enjoyed it. I thought it was sweet, especially like the second half of the movie. Some of the musical sequences, I think, are too long. the two leads, Dia Frampton and Ashley Argata, I guess are both singers. So I think that's why they sing a lot. But nevertheless, it was cute. I thought they had pretty good chemistry. And so if you're up for a New Year's movie, then you should check that out.
All right.
Yeah. Okay. So last one that we're going to talk about is The Santa Squad. And so this movie stars Rebecca Dalton from Good Witch fame and Aaron Ashmore. And it's an unemployed art teacher accepts a job with the Santa Squad to help lift the spirits of a wealthy widower, Gordon, and his two adorable daughters. As she helps the broken family rediscover the magic of Christmas, she finds something she didn't expect, true love. So overall, what did you think of this one?
Overall, I mean, I enjoyed it. I like the setup of the story. It's kind of the traditional Christmas story as far as these things go. But I have to say, I adored Bill and Connie, the older couple. Oh, my gosh.
Oh, yeah. They were fun. Yeah.
Loved them.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, it was a cute Christmas story.
I would like this movie better if it wasn't called The Santa Squad, because that led me to an expectation of getting a Santa Squad, which we didn't get.
I would agree with you.
Like, that sounds so amazing. The Santa Squad. Are you kidding me? That sounds so fun. This should have been called The Christmas Nanny.
Oh,
that's what
good
it was.
One. Yes.
Yeah.
Because, you know, actually, this should have, for it to be called The Santa Squad, this should have a lot more kids in it.
A lot. Yeah, and a lot more Santas.
Yes, agreed.
A squad of Santas.
A squad
which
of
I never Santa. Got. And I was very disappointed. But other than that, it was perfectly cute and I enjoyed it. She ends up getting assigned to work with Gordon in his house. Mm-hmm. And he's dating Kimmy, who's obviously the worst person, not only because she wants him to send his kids to boarding school, which
she's horrible.
which means you're evil in one of these movies. But then also, she has a giant white Christmas tree, and that is code in these movies for being a terrible human. If you have a white Christmas tree,
you're horrible.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, as soon as she's gone, they immediately go and cut down a live tree
and replace
the white tree.
Right.
And I have dreamed of having a white Christmas tree for many years. I actually have a small white Christmas tree because I don't have the guts, the fortitude to have my main Christmas tree be the white Christmas tree. I've watched too many Hallmark movies.
You know what? I have to tell you, it takes guts, because my mom took our family tree one year, put it away, bought this enormous white tree, and put burgundy Christmas balls all over it. And I didn't even know what to say to her.
Your mom's a hero.
We stood there and stared at it, and we told her how beautiful it was. We didn't even know what to do.
But only one year? That was it?
It was two. It went up the next year anyone could do anything about it.
Yeah, that was, and then this Kimmy here with her like blue ornaments and
Fabric or something.
Yeah, I mean, I have never seen a white Christmas tree that's that big as was in this movie.
It was huge. It was like a 15-footer. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm like, the girl has some design. I love it. So we find out that Gordon, he missed out on a bike, the bike he wanted as a kid. And this is the main catalyst for him becoming a successful businessman. And that he wanted to make sure that his kids never missed out on a Christmas present that they really wanted. But of course, what they really want is time with their dad.
Exactly.
So I do appreciate that this film did not give us the scene, which is so cringy and I hate, of sitting in the boardroom and the man lost in business stopping and saying, I've got to leave right now. And you know what I mean? I hate that scene. It's so bad.
He spent all of his time in his office at home, but it was behind this little desk. And I was like, a man as powerful as you should really have a much bigger desk.
Yeah, that's a good point. Whenever they have those scenes, I'm always just finish the meeting. Finish. Don't stop. So he is dating Kimmy, and then she comes in and she's the best. What kid wouldn't love her? She teaches them how to make gifts and ornaments, and there's glitter everywhere, and
she brings in a box of stuff that decorated their entire house, essentially.
Yeah.
They decorated everything, which sends Kimmy over the edge.
Yeah, that's right. The girls love her. The kids were, I thought, pretty cute for mm-hmm. this kind of
oh
film.
I thought so too. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And but they have this whole scene where so Allie has car trouble, and the girls are like, you should take her dad, take mm-hmm. her. And it was like this was some kind of date, but am I wrong that they had dinner at her house?
Yeah, they did, and I don't understand how she did that.
I don't understand how she did it, and it seems a little rude to me.
Yeah.
he takes her home, then she has to make dinner?
Exactly. I mean, they could have picked something up. I think on the way home, why don't we just stop here? I mean, I kind of have a lot of money. I can buy us dinner.
Yeah. Instead of, you have to make dinner
right.
when I'm the one helping you, and this is supposed to be a semi-date. I was a little kind of confused by that.
Yeah.
And so then they have this whole scene where they're baking cookies mm-hmm. and they're outside, and oven mitt is left in the oven and it starts to smoke up.
Right.
And he has this just insane reaction. He says, yeah, I can't risk my girls around you anymore.
Like, I mean, the whole thing is crazy.
It's crazy. Because I mean, it's just like,
And it's another situation where I would have been just like, all right, everyone calm down. It's enough. Yeah. We're fine. But he throws her out, like fires her right there.
Yeah. I mean, it's as if they never had the smoke alarm ever go off in their home.
Exactly.
Ever. It's never happened. So he fires her for this. And then the girls are like, wait a minute, we did it. We're the ones who left the oven mitt in the oven.
Right.
So I'd be pretty mad at him for doing this.
I would too. Well, and then she goes back that evening for her last check. I'm like, still yeah, a little fresh. I think I would have
been like, I know I would have too, for sure. Until after New Year's, probably.
Exactly.
And so then Bill ends up in the emergency room, which I think helped them kind of get over the oven mitt trauma. And so they're concerned. And then we find out Connie says, oh, I should have told him that I loved him all along, which was really cute. And it turns out it's just a heart murmur or whatever. It's not like a big deal.
Yeah, medicine. He messed his medicine up.
Yeah, he messed his medicine. And so then you have Gordon kind of being a lame Santa. He doesn't even have any stuffing in his... He doesn't have a beard or anything.
Nothing. Yeah, that is a beard.
Yeah, I'm like, come on.
I'm like, I hope
that would have been really
believe still because you're really not going to throw a loop there.
Yeah, I mean, come on. It would have been really cute if he'd like gone up to Rebecca Dalton and been like, ho ho ho, or something like that. But no, they did not. So then he decides he's going to take a leave of absence from his job. Because as we've learned today, jobs are evil. Jobs are bad. And he's going to be with his kids and it's going to be amazing. And then they kiss under the mistletoe and she's going to move into the house.
Yeah. That
so
was
they're
fast.
Progressing.
I mean, right. I guess she'll have her own wing, you know, until.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was really fast.
It was. It really was.
And they're all
so,
kind of
there we
together
go.
As a family. You know, so it's a big, they've made their own little family there with the new couple and the guy from the rec center.
Yeah. So aside from the disappointing title, what would you give the Saints Squad?
Maybe a 3. Maybe a 2.5.
Yeah, I agree with you. I'm going to give it a 3. It was fine, but I don't think it's good as the other ones. So
yeah, I think that as with any weekend, they start strong and then end. But you know, Hallmark is the opposite.
It's a Monday movie.
They try to end strong. Yeah, it was
a Monday movie. The Monday movie is like a bonus movie.
It is.
So there we go. That is the films for this week. Let us know what you think. If you got to see any of these, if you liked them, didn't like them, if you agree with us, put it in the comment section. We'd love to hear your thoughts or let us know on Twitter. And so where can people find your podcast in your social medias and everything?
We are at Podcast Cozy. And you can find everything you can probably find our podcast just about anywhere. But check out iTunes or Spotify where you can find us there. We are right in the middle of season 4 right now.
Great. And you can find me at Rachel's Reviews, all of our social media, iTunes, YouTube, and on Rotten Tomatoes. So check that out. And make sure you're following the podcast at Hallmarkies Pod and Hallmarkies Podcast all over social media. And if you're listening on iTunes, please leave your ratings and reviews for both of our podcasts. We really appreciate it. And if you are listening on YouTube, please give this video a thumbs up and subscribe to the channel. We appreciate that so much. We also have our Patreon group, which has tons of fun perks and benefits. And we have our merch store, which has holiday designs on sale right now. So please check that out. We'd really, 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 really appreciate it. And thank you so much for coming on and doing this. This was a lot of fun. I really enjoyed it. And so
thank you for having me.
Yeah, it was great. Well, Merry Christmas, everybody.
Merry Christmas.